Okay, now we'll begin lecture. And just to remind you, tomorrow's exam, number two. And you guys are going to be taking it at about 3:45, 3:50, second hour of the day. And so we'll dismiss, or no, we won't dismiss, we'll break at about 3:45, and then take a 5-minute break and then start the test. Okay, kind of like last time. About homework three, I want to make some comments. Let me bring this down a little bit. Mic's a little hot. For those of you that got graded by me with the red ink, a lot of you did good. You were right on the money, and which is good. But some of you made some errors because you didn't read carefully, and I want to advise everyone of a couple examples. For instance, in the calculation of the mass from the atomic mass unit, you know, whatever it was, 38.91638 or something, into kilograms, a lot of you did not use all six figures, and you ought to have done that. So for instance, here's the heavy, and this is for my answer key, the heavy calcium, in atomic mass units, it's 40.9618. Then you multiply that by all six digits of that conversion factor. Now there's a place, National Institute of Science and Standards and Technology, NIST, and what they do, one of the things that they do is they compute and they compile a list of the fundamental constants of nature. You know, like the speed of light, the permittivity constant, you know, to buku decimal points, and the atomic mass unit. And this is not all the units that I could have put on there. They know it very, very precisely. Anyway, so this one comes out to 68.0187 times 10 to the minus 27 kilograms. And I saw a lot, or 6.80187 times 10 to the minus 26. I used that in my calculations, and I want you to start doing that as well. I saw a lot of people with 6.08. The problem with that is, if you're trying to do a radius or a separation to the nearest 0.01 meters, you need this stuff out here, all right? And there were some of you that I actually marked down because you know, the round off error is just, you should have spotted them. I think I wasn't ultra harsh, but I did score a few people down for that. So you have to be wise. Another thing, I saw a lot of people with 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 for the electron volts conversion factor to joules. And that one, you should have used 1.602 as well. Although, I also noticed that the heavy ion was, the numbers just happened to work out that if you had a little bit of slop in your calculation from rounding off and stuff, you could still get right on the money, pretty close, as far as the radius of curvature. But the light one was a little trickier. It had the numbers that were really sensitive to round off error. I was pretty generous about the speeds. And so some of you answered in scientific notation. Some of you didn't. And I had one student that answered 7 for both of the speeds, 7 meters per second. Clearly incorrect. I had another student that had an answer that was 33 times the speed of light. And just so you know, the speed of light is for all physical objects, except for science fiction novels, of course. It is the limiting speed for all physical objects. So no physical objects can actually get to the speed of light except for photons and gravitons. All right, they both travel at the speed of light, and only at the speed of light. And they only exist at the speed of light. You know, we can exist at all different kinds of speeds, you know, in your car and whatnot. But no matter how good your car, how close you are to a black hole, you cannot break and get exactly 100%. You know, so you can't ace the speed of light. Nobody can. So if your answer comes out, you know, 2 times the speed of light, which is 3 × 10⁸ meters per second. And granted, I know it by heart because I use it all the time in relativity. But, you know, I don't know if I took points off for that student. But anyways, be alert to that kind of stuff. A few errors. There was in the 50 papers or so that I graded, I saw a few students that had the same kind of error. So I take it that they were studying together or they were looking at something from the internet that was taking them off to La La Land, but a little bit away from where they should have been. So I saw some radii mishandled. And that was a serious error in the diagram. And so I saw like 3 or 4 students with the same error of drawing. So when you're studying with that's why it's good to study with friends, you know, and you can sometimes catch errors like that. If nobody, you know, that group, nobody caught it. Still, it's good to study with friends. Also, this admonition also applies to everybody, especially when you're studying. You know the old saying, nobody knows if you're a dog on the internet. You know, and so if you're looking at some physics website, they might be, you know, some maniac, you know, that's just making stuff up like F equals MA to the second power, you know, or some nonsense. And so I think we got, every once in a while I'll see students with stuff that's way out. I don't know where they get it. Also, for those of you that were graded by me, I spent several minutes, if you had some serious errors, I spent a few minutes looking at your numbers, and I actually cranked through a few of your numbers to see how did they get that. And some of you, I couldn't figure out how you did it. So I figured that there must have been like somebody typed in a 6 instead of a 5 or something, I don't know. Which, you know, that happens to me too, but usually I could figure out where your errors are. And by the way, on exam 2 tomorrow, you're going to have at least one calculation using clickers. And remember, on those, I can give partial credit. With this Scantron, you either get it or you don't. All right? But with the clicking, so I might have 2 or 3 clicking questions now that you've done them a couple times. And so that'll be nice as far as extra credit. All right, any questions about this stuff before I pour out my heart about Wiley Plus? All right, I'm now going to share my mental feelings about Wiley Plus. I am very antagonistic to Wiley Plus. Because they said that their scores, your scores are sitting lovely and nice over there at WileyPlus.com. The problem is they don't get shipped down into precious Canvas. And you know what? I blame Canvas. I don't blame you guys. I'll kind of blame Wiley Plus. But I definitely blame Canvas because Canvas is a bear cat. As far as getting Canvas to talk with other systems, it's even getting it to talk to me is, you know, pain in the neck. But I'm aware of some of you have messaged me in web courses about it. Some of you are merely stewing about the problems with Wiley Plus grades. You know, I want to tell you something. Couple weeks ago when we first noticed it, and then I asked them, and they said, oh, yeah, use the grades refresh. I did the grades refresh a couple times, and when it does that, it gives you an error report. And at that time, there were like 63 errors. In other words, there were 63 grades, you know, a few dozen students that didn't. Now there's over 1,000. It's like 1,200. So I, you know, I gave those guys a call on Friday, and I said, that, you know, this is not, you know, this is not happy. This is not making me happy. So anyway, all right, let's go on to some exam two comments. All right, as far as topics and so forth, I want to remind you, 20.13. It was just the little dibs and dabs of chapter 20 that we talked about the Monday after the test. That's about RC circuits. Remember, we had this exponential decay. We talked about half-life, and we talked about 1 over E, and stuff like that. So that was a couple Mondays ago. Wow. Last Monday. It's like sands through the hourglass. The other chapters and subsections and whatnot are in the discussion posting that Rodoline started. It's called Chapter Sections. And you know what? Even this is a little bit obsolete. We're going to finish last two chapter topics in Chapter 22. And then we're actually not going to do 6 pages today. We're going to do about 1 page in chapter 23. So these first two topics, reactants and phasor, they come before the thing I'm really going to be talking about, oscillations. And we'll get to that at the end of the lecture today. And then tomorrow we'll reinforce and wrap chapter 23. About oscillations, and then just so you're not misled here, I don't want you to be mentally discombobulated, reactants and phasors for the reactants and the impedance, those will be after the test, okay? But the oscillations, we'll do a wrap on the oscillations tomorrow and a bunch of other stuff to get your minds warmed up. For the exam. Question? I was just talking about chapter 23. Everything I just said about the last 4 or 5 minutes was about chapter 23. So it'll become clear to you by the end of class. We're just going to have a very little teeny bit of chapter 23, like a page and a half, and one diagram and one formula. So, but we're going to reinforce it and have discussion about it tomorrow and a few other items and just get warmed up for that. Yeah. It'll be chapter 20.13, and then the rest of the stuff in the discussion posting, except for we won't go as far into chapter 23 as I mentioned in the discussion posting, okay? So we're just going to be doing one diagram and one formula from chapter 23 today. And you'll see by the end of class. Question? Ooh. Yeah, I think it's 23.4 resonance. It's in my slides at the end of class. You'll see. And I'll have the page. You don't have page numbers in the online. I've got it down to the number of a four. Do you have a formula, equation numbers? And you have figures, figure numbers. I've got it down to that. So it's, you know, it should be good. All right, let's get down to Lenz's Law. And we're going to do some right-hand rule instruction here. And hopefully you guys will start to crush like bugs the right-hand rule questions. All right? So let's look at Lenz's Law. Here's figure 2215. And figure 2215 is, this part of it is lovely. It shows a bar magnet with the N pole of the bar magnet approaching a loop of wire. The loop's got a little resistance in there. You can see it down there. And it's very nice. But the conceptual example number 8 that goes with it is semi-heinous. I didn't really like it that much. And I know a few people were asking me about it in discussions. And I want to talk about this diagram and the conceptual example just a little bit so that you're not so mentally discombobulated. But figure 22.15, figure A, is righteous. And if you define the positive flux as this loop catching rightward field lines, all right, that's just a decision you make. But if that's your decision, that's basically that's what I decide to do, just for conversational purposes. Then as this thing moves toward the loop, it's catching more and more field lines, because as you get closer and closer to the actual source, the magnet, the field lines are denser and denser. So in that, you know, whatever the size of that little loop is, you know, 2.78 square centimeters, you're getting more and more field lines being caught by that loop as the magnet moves from left and closer to the loop to the right. All right. So delta phi, the change in the flux, is positive. You're getting more of those rightward field lines. All right. Good. Now, what Lenz's law says, the induced current is going to try to counteract that. So if you're catching over time more rightward field lines as this one does, Lenz's law says that the current in the loop that's induced is going to produce leftward field lines. All right, and that's where the right-hand rule comes in. Right, so the current, they don't have a current signified in this diagram. All right. But they do in this figure B. And my wonderful students, there's something really shaky about this figure. Because, you know, and I don't know why they did this figure the way they did, and they don't even give me, the instructor, figure C. Figure B is confusing, in my opinion. All right, so this is wrong. You know, this one, that current that, you know, with the right hand in that picture, part B, that's not going to give you leftward field lines. That's going to give you some more rightward field lines, because that's the way the current comes into the, see how this, here's my hand, okay, into the loop. You know, they're going to be going that way. That's not what you want. You want field lines going this way. All right, so the induced current goes the other way than this diagram, all right? And that's actually figure 22.15C. So, you know, this one, I want you to just kind of figure, whoa, I just tangled myself up with my cable here. Figure B, you can't really cross it out in the ebook, but I mean, just mentally remember, no, don't do it, all right? But do go with figure 22.15C, because that is, and their wording in the actual conceptual example, I don't know, it must have been like, I don't know, maybe it was an engineering major that snuck into their office or something, but the wording is really dubious, very troublous. So just go with the diagram, 22.15C. And that's the one. And I can't show it to you on the screen because they don't give it. Their set of figures doesn't include C for some reason. Question. Yeah. The external field lines are rightward, and the loop is catching more of them. Therefore, the ones that it manufactures with the induced current are going to be counteract that. All right. So you have to really think about catching more rightward, Jade. Or losing, or you might be catching, on another problem, you might be catching leftward. Or, inward or outward, inward is X's, outward is dots. All right, so you just got to kind of look at it and think. And it's pretty, it can be tricky. Tatiana. Yeah, so here's the one. In this one, they haven't shown you any current moving. But if the bar magnet's moving, then there will be current. And this is a diagram that's trying to get you to think, okay, which way is it gonna go? All right, so it's gonna go like this, it's gonna go up and around and produce field lines in this direction. All right, leftward field lines. So it's going to be magnet against magnet. It's going to be bar magnet against electromagnet. Okay? And so it's always, a reaction. So, yeah, that's what the minus sign in Lenz's law and in Michael Faraday's inductance law, law of induction, that minus sign is the fact that it's countering, the change.
But also in the book, they explain Lenz's law, in terms of the change in magnetic flux and polarity. Like, it's not just like,
yeah, and this diagram, Tatiana asked a good question, and it's good that we're going to go over it. I do not want you to get tripped up on this polarity business. Oh, I was going to make a diagram for this. When they're talking about polarity and stuff, I was confused. I had to read it about 17 times. But let me get some chalk here. When they're talking about polarity, they're talking about this. They're saying, all right, you've got this loop, and here's point A, and here's point B. And what they're saying is, do you have a battery like this, or do you have a battery like this? Let me make that a little clearer. All right, so the big plate on the left, so this is the positive side, okay? Is this the, and so that's what they're trying to get you to think of, but I. Darn tootin'. I'm never gonna ask you a question like that. That would be like if I wanted to, I would never want to do that, just because it's confusing, but if you could figure this out, you're good, and then you just figure that out and then kind of trace the way it goes through the, so on this one, it's going to go counterclockwise around the loop, and then it's going to go left to right through the battery, or through the resistance.
Resistance.
No, you have to, you when you're doing a right-hand rule for Lenz's law, you have to know what Lenz's law is doing first. You have to know, okay, Lenz's law, leftward, and then you say, all right, how do I get, do I get this for leftward, or do I get this for leftward? All right, so you got to know that. Lenz's law, and so that's why you start with the flux that you're, the increase in the flux or the decrease in the flux, and then make your decisions based on that. Question? Janelle. That is incorrect. That is not what I'm saying. I just said what you got to look at. What you have to look at, not the field, not the bar magnet field. What if that bar magnet field is going backwards? Then you're losing positive field lines. And then you got to completely dip. The induced current is going to try to replace positive field lines. So what you have to look at is the change in the flux. Not the field itself. You know what it's an interaction of the circuit and the field, not just the field. It's not something about the field. It's about the field interacting with the circuit, especially the loop part of the circuit. So, Tatiana. Yeah, it depends on how you've arranged your flux accounting. Remember, that's a separate accounting decision. And I just decided to say, remember at the beginning of this, here it is. I define positive flux as field lines heading to the right through the loop. Okay, once you make that decision, and it's independent, you can just as easily say, all right, I want to call everything that's going left positive. You know, if your car's parked out to the left, okay, everything aimed at my car is positive. You know, you may have some reason that you want leftward being positive, but I just chose rightward being positive. And then you decide, then you look at the motion, you look at the distribution of the field lines and make your decision. Am I gaining rightward, or am I losing rightward? I mean, if this starts backing up, you know, then you're going to be losing rightward. Then you get a totally different situation. And so you just have to, so as I was saying, Janelle, always look at what is happening with the flux. Decide what positive flux and negative flux are for you. Then look to see if you're gaining positive or gaining negative or whatever whatever it happens to be. Question. Alexis.
Yes. But in this example, if we define flux as the opposite, what exactly would happen?
Alexis wants me to do this in reverse. Okay. If I decide, now you could turn off your ears if you want. Okay. Too long, don't read. All right. But if you want, if you decide that this is positive flux, all right, then the change in the flux is negative. You're getting, so field lines poking through to the left are positive. The field lines poking through to the right are negatory, all right? And then you make all your decisions based on that. So it just depends on what you want to do. Or at least at that stage. You know, you decide how to account for flux, and then you look at what the sources are doing. Alexis Ramos, you're asking me what's gonna be on the test. And I would not tell you, and in fact, I haven't even written the test.
But like if we're doing problems with this in general, is that something that's going to be defined in the problem?
No, you're going to have to make decisions. Okay. I'll give you something like this. And then, matter of fact, let's do some clicker questions. And let's see if I can fry your guys' brains. All right, so remember, none of that stuff. All right, clickers, let's go. Right hand rule practice. Now, okay. What we're going to make a note, we're going to look at this figure 22:16, and we're just going to walk through some of the basic concepts for this picture. And it's the next page from the one we were just looking at. And it shows a ring of copper, so a nice conductor, falling through a magnetic field, and those are X's. So the magnetic field's going into the board, into your paper, right? And it's falling through there. And so, and then it comes out the other side. So this is like falling between the two poles of a big horseshoe magnet. You know, between the two poles, you got a pretty nice uniform field, but then once you're outside of there, the field dims out pretty much. So this is kind of an approximation of that. Okay, question one. So this is about position one, which is the upper position. I see people going like this. Remember to read carefully and think. Twenty seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Wrong cursor. I don't see any field lines up there. So it's not catching Jack. So you gotta be able to say, Janelle, flux ain't changing. It's zip right now and it'll be zip until you get to position, you know, just above position two, and then you start catching something. All right, then you gotta start thinking about. So I saw you guys out there with the right hand rule and stuff, and but this one's a cinchy one. All right. Position two. Now we got to think. See, Janelle, you gotta, this is where you gotta make a decision. Wow, you guys are fast. Oh, I just clicked it closed. Let me do it again. Okay, revote. Revote to what you just did. I was going to look, I clicked the wrong button. Okay, 20 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one, zero. Yeah, you guys are geniuses. 85% got this right. Yeah, you're starting to get some of the X's. You know, at this point, you've got half X's and half zip zap. All right, so your flux is pi r squared times the field strength divided by 2 at this instant. All right, but in a little bit after that, you're going to have more than a half circle's worth, so let's do another question. As the ring passes, as the world turns, like sand through the hourglass. Now you got to break. You got to break out the right-hand rule. Yeah. Yeah, so a catching field lines is my new verbiage for what I was saying Thursday that got everybody so... Megan Reiser. It was pretty good going to office hours, right? It's usually a good strategy if you can make it. What? You guys are, okay, 10 seconds to vote. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ding. Yeah, so now let's think about how this works. You're catching X's from the external, you know, your horseshoe magnet. So your loop wants to produce some dots. You know, so it's going to form a current that's going to form. But now let me ask you this. Dun, 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 dun. Direction of the field line. Or direction of the current, I should say. Field line, we know. Mr. Thompson, what is your first name again? Matthew, good. You got it? I see you going with this. No, you don't. It's not stirring soup. You just, it's either this or it's either this. Don't stir soup. All right, 20 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one, zero. Ding. Ah, yeah, geniuses, 82%. Yeah, so here's how you do it. All right. So your loop is circular, and it's, you know, and you want dots. That means coming out of the board. So zing, there you go. So that's counterclockwise in this view. So if you got caught napping on that one, make a note. It's counterclockwise. Now, okay, I'm ready to... I'm trying to fry your guys' brains. It's getting harder and harder, but maybe this one will do it. You guys are up there at the 85% level. So if I gave you like 10 of these questions... Ten out of 25. Position 3, that's right in the middle. Okay, 10, 15 seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, I'm going to give you... I'm going to let you look at this, the answers that you've compiled. All right, now I haven't indicated which one is correct. However, I'm going to let you re-vote or change your vote if you want and tell you that and this will help me writing the test, actually. B, I want you to think of as catching more X field lines, and C, losing more. This is screwy. Okay, D, I want you to think of D as catching more new dot field lines. All right, so change, and then A is, and E are still the same. I'm going to have to do this carefully on the test. Anyways, change your great ear. Wait a minute. Let me do this. I'm going to stop this question, and I'm going to do this. Let's do the question one more time. And this time, hit the refresh key and type it in as A, B, C, D, or E. Whichever one you want, now I'll be able to grade it more than one of them correct, because I can see you guys are... Okay, so take a second to re... Just whatever, hit the refresh key first, and then type in A, B, C, D, or E, whatever you had. All right, hurry up, get your data in there. Okay, 10 seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right. Now, let's go. I'll just show you the answers. You guys just pretty much put in the same ones. Now, that's all right. I don't mind it, because it's ambiguous the way I've got it written. So just changing the wording is not good. I have to totally rewrite it for the test. I mean, if you're going to have something like this on the test, I would have to totally rewrite it. I'm not saying it's going to be on the test. But A is what I wanted to be correct, but I'm going to, I know a lot of you guys are thinking B, because yeah, it is. I mean, it's, let me switch back to the laptop. Yeah, as it goes through there, yeah, it actually is catching different field lines. So that's ambiguous. But you know what? In reality, in reality, it's still pi r squared times whatever the field strength is, all the way down from here. Once the top edge clears this upper boundary, and once the bottom, until the bottom edge touches the bottom boundary, you've got pi r squared times the magnetic field all the way down. So you're not really, your flux is not increasing. So I should actually ask this question in terms of flux. This is what I thought the answer should be, but I'm grading A and B, both of them correct, because I understand what you're doing. Now, I have one more question. And this question, I hate to say it, it is going to burn your brains because it's about position four. I want you to hit the refresh button again. And you're going to type in a set of letters. All right? And I'm giving you a table of 10 letters to use from A through J to form a description of the situation in the copper ring as it moves through position four. Okay, so now you decide, and you know, there can be multiple different correct statements. So you make the call. All right? Except don't use Sharknado, French fries, or enjoy sharks. But that's just up there for an example. VUJ. So if you want to type in sharks, enjoy French fries, but don't type that in. But I mean, if you did, you would type in VUJ. If I see anybody put anything about French fries or Sharknado, I'm talking about everything that we just did. And you can make it fairly simple or fairly elaborate. I'll look at it and then just, you know, I'll be able to decide if your sentence is right. This is, you really have to think before you decide. I mean, you can make any kind, there's several simple true sentences you could make. Or there's a, you know, you could make deluxe sentences. What you type in must be true. You write the sentence. You can make any number of letters you want. You have up to, I think the limit is 14. But you can probably do something with three or four that's pretty nice. And hey, you guys, hit the send key as soon as you type in your answer. And if you want to change it, you can just change it and then type in the send key. 45 seconds. Seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one, zero. Okay, here we go. Take a look. Let's go down the list. Who used V and J? All right, let's look at ADEG, A-D-E-G. Catches X field lines, induces counterclockwise, catches new. That's not right. It's not catching new. It's losing. All right, so that one would be marked incorrect. Let's look at another fairly short one here. Okay. Four of you voted for BCF. Loses old dot field lines. Not right. Clockwise current. Now that might be right. So in it, now here's how, if you want to jot down what I would say, it's losing X's. So it wants to produce more X's, therefore clockwise. So clockwise current F is actually F by itself would be correct. Clockwise current. You know, clockwise current will give some X's, which you're losing because you're moving out of the field. So the induced current's going to. All right, now tomorrow. So here's something interesting, you guys. If I were to ask you a question like this in the clicker part of the test tomorrow, everyone that answered F would automatically have partial credit, even if the first part of their sentence was wrong. Because here, F in itself is a bundle of truth. Clockwise current, perfectly fine. You can say other things, but you can say that and be true. Jade. It's moving out of the horseshoe magnet. So it used to have, you know, look at position three. Position three, it's got about two solid field lines. Now it's down to one and it's barely hanging on. All right, so it wants to produce some more X's into the screen, and those are from this circulation, which is clockwise. Cara Dominio. The this flux.
Yeah.
No, actually, you know what? Actually, you're correct because it's making its own field lines. Yeah, you could say that. You could. Man, see this? These kind of questions, you could come up with concepts that are righteous. No. I can't. No, she was saying catches new field lines because the induced current is making more X's. Oh, okay. And you know what? Our next topic, Kara, yeah. Listen up. Our next topic is exactly that. The whole topic of inductance. And this is the very end of chapter 23. Question up here. It would be, because it's making its own field lines. All right. Let's keep going. I want to finish lecture before 5 o'clock. And I said I'd probably dismiss a little early today, but we're doing good. You guys are asking a lot of questions. We're thinking together, we're talking together, and that's good. But let's keep going. The idea of inductance, it comes from inducing fields in a loop. So induce, inductance. And really, this is a great picture. If you have an electromagnet on the left, this one over here, your primary, it's in this example, it's connected to an AC, alternating current generator. So, you know, so the current's going left and then it's going right, left and right at a certain frequency. It's going to be pushing rightward field lines and then extracting them and then pushing leftward field lines into the secondary coil. Now, this secondary coil, so the primary coil has varying current. The secondary current has got jack. It's got a solid core. Okay, so it's probably got an iron core. So this is iron core to iron core. Actually, no, I take that back. Those look like just a cylinder. Anyways, there's nothing driving this secondary coil. There's no AC circuit current. There's no DC battery. You know, it's just whatever is induced from the primary, okay? And so what we say is that the magnetic field lines from the primary are caught by the secondary, okay? And they induce leftward, in this picture, they'll induce leftward field lines in the secondary. So the secondary is going to be producing current that goes around the coil in this way, you know, like this. It's going to produce some leftward field lines, and that is and the reaction, the amount of time that it takes to do that encodes the inductance, and the inductance of the secondary coils is basically a factor of, you know, its design. How big is it? How many coils? Does it have iron in the core? Does it have wood in the core? Does it have lead in the core? What's the temperature of the lead? What's the temperature of the iron? You know, if the iron's hot, if the lead is cold, you know, you might get different induced currents. All right? Now, this phenomenon, a primary lighting up a secondary, is actually what Michael Faraday discovered. There's his coil. He had an iron ring, and he had a primary up here. And down here, he had a secondary. And he noticed that when he turned the primary on, his secondary was connected to a current measuring device called a galvanometer, which, have you guys used galvanometers in lab yet? You probably will. All right, it's a device that you can use to measure current or voltage. And it's, you know, we've been using it for centuries. So he had this bottom one hooked up to a galvanometer, and he noticed that, you know, when he, and the top one, the primary, he had hooked up to a battery, and he had some nice big batteries. And he noticed when he flipped the switch, or when he opened the switch, when he turned it on or when he turned it off, the secondary lit up with just a blip of current. And that's what he was looking for. He was looking for magnetism to produce current, to produce electricity. And so this is what he actually found. Now, it's at the end of our chapter, but it was the very beginning of all of his chapters. All right? So that's Michael Faraday's discovery. Now, if your current changes, it should say if your current changes in the primary. Now, here it is, Janelle. The current changes in the primary, the flux will change in the secondary. All right, then you look at your secondary, okay, my flux is changing, my counter flux from my induced current is going to give me some of these, or maybe some of these, you know, depending on what the current's doing. Because this thing's alternating current. So it's going to be rattling northward field lines and southward field lines back and forth as the current goes positive and negative through that coil. Now, the formula is just like the other ones, but this one is what we would call the mutual inductance, capital M. And capital M, if you remember, the size and shape of the coil depend on, you know, if you're working with a solenoid anyways, the size and the shape of the coil are all encoded in the magnetic field. And then the area for the flux calculation is in the size of the secondary coil. So the magnetic field produced by the primary, if it's a solenoid, the central field anyways, mu naught times little n times the current in the primary. All right, so if that changes, the magnetic field of the primary changes everywhere. And for that reason, the flux delta phi by delta t includes the current in the numerator. So this is the flux term here, and some of the other flux terms are off in this constant. Now that's the mutual inductance M. So as I said, that includes the geometry of both coils. All right, the mutual inductance. You know, because you have to know how big the other coil is, and how far away it is. You know, if you wanted, and to do the inductance, the mutual inductance of this system with these curved field lines, you'd have to do beaucoup. I wouldn't even want to do it. A lot of calculus and trig. But I mean, you could do it. It'd be pretty bodacious. It'd be a tough calculation. But I mean, electrical engineers, that's what they do, that's among other things. They calculate that kind of thing. All right, so the solenoid is, its magnetic field, which is in the numerator over here, is proportional to the current I. So we can simplify this to delta I in the primary over delta T. And it's proportional to, or its constant of proportionality is what we call the inductance. Now, the inductance is measured in Henry's. And that's named after the other guy that was really big on all this, the American scientist named Joseph Henry. And a Henry is 1 volt second per ampere. So it's, you know, one of those bodacious constants, but it's... All right, so that's mutual inductance. Now, here's another one, and Kara, this is where your idea came in. You can get self-inductance, and that is this is figure 22-28. A coil, it can be catching its own field lines. You know, if it goes from 0 to 2.5 amps, and then down a negative 2.5 amps, i.e. the other direction, and then back up to 2.5 amps at a certain frequency, yeah, it's catching and losing field lines out the wazoo. And for that reason, the inductance, the self-inductance, which is symbolized capital L, is the proportionality constant for the EMF. So the magnitude of L, and I've got L here. Here it is. L is, it looks a lot like the previous one, the previous inductance, capital M, but this one is in a single circuit. It's a self-inductance, and it depends on the geometry of the coil and the core material. That's a quote from page 638. So if you don't have page numbers, you can look at figure 22.28, and it's somewhere near there in the ebook. And in this case, the current is from the source, you know, but for Michael Faraday, he was just turning on and off a DC current, you know, from a battery. So it was, you know, it went from zero to 0.5 amps or something, and then back down to zero. It was an alternating current, but he invented alternating current. He figured out how to make generators and stuff. And so what's important here is that Lenz's law says that, you know, that the minus sign here, this minus sign up here, that's from Lenz's law. This inductance is fighting the source of current. Whatever its change is, if it's an on-off circuit breaker like Michael Faraday used, if it's an AC generator like we have in the lab, the self-inductance is fighting against that. And so it's, and you can read about it in the neighborhood of figure 22.28. And I want you to think of it, this last sentence, it's like a magnetic inertia. And that is a significant sentence. It is not inaccurate. And matter of fact, it is amazingly accurate. So I want to talk about this very last sentence, that L is like a magnetic inertia. All right? Now, in this part of 22, if you read a little bit further in there, you'll see that they say that the energy is right here. This is the energy in the inductor, 1/2 L times the square of the current. Now, if you have a capacitor, and we've already talked about this, in a capacitor, so if you have an LC circuit, inductance and capacitance, the energy stored in the capacitor is 1/2 C times the square of the charge load on the capacitor. Now here's where it gets interesting, and I want you to look at this and think. I've got this set up so that you can think. The current is the time rate of change of the charge load on the capacitor. All right. When you discharge the capacitor, it flows back through the circuit. You know, you charge it up, then you discharge it. Flows. You know, it's exponential decay and stuff like that. Remember that? So the capacitor will discharge. And if it's also going through an inductor, you know, if there's a little coil in the circuit, the current is actually equal to the time rate of change of the charge load on the capacitor. I want you to think about those equations. What do you see? Do you see anything that gives rise to inspiration or gives rise to nostalgia? In other words, does it remind you of anything? Does it inspire you to think into a parallel universe, a parallel topic? What do you see? Miss Rufus, you got an idea? What do you think? Yeah, you could put, yeah. So this would be delta Q over delta T quantity squared. Yeah, so let's do that.
Big shots, you know, in their office they have the big chalkboard and all equations. That's what we do. We write some equation that we come up with, and then we look at it for a month or until the cleaning lady comes in and says, you know, that looks like. There's a famous cartoon about that. You know, Einstein's at the chalkboard. He's trying to E equals MC to the third, equals MC squared, or no, equals MC to the third, equals MC to the fourth, equals MC to the fifth, and they're all crossed out. And then the cleaning lady comes in, and she said, she with the mop bucket and the broom and everything, and she puts her hands on her hips, and she said, yep, this is all squared away. And so it shows Einstein going, bing, you know, equals MC squared. So what do you see? You're staring at it now. You don't have a month. Ding. Who said that? Who? Is you were saying, you were thinking it.
Yeah, I didn't.
Or she was. I heard what, it's all right. You can admit it. Were you thinking that? Okay. Students, what is this second equation down here? What kind of system is that? Spring. It's a harmonic oscillator system. This is not a coincidence. The circuit will oscillate. If you have some R, some L, and some C, every circuit's going to have some R. So, but if you put a C capacitor and an L inductor in there, a coil of some kind, there it is. This is what I want you to think about for tomorrow. Figure 23.16. This, yes, we're going to talk about this before the test, okay? I'll probably have about 10 clicker questions about this diagram. So students, every single device that you've got that operates with frequencies, there it is. Buku frequency, you know, buku parts of the electronics have got capacitors and inductors in there, and they oscillate. Now, what I want you to do for tomorrow, I want you to study this diagram, and there's a formula right below it. It's at the top of the page in the regular book. I don't know what the ebook it looks. Well, the ebook looks the same.
And this is really all I care about in chapter 23. You know, the phasers are nice, but this, the reason that this is important is because A, all electronics are loaded with this. You know, when you hear about people talking about bandwidth, you know, dude, you're taking all the bandwidth. They're talking about frequencies. The greater the frequency range, the more bandwidth you have, the more data you can transport across the system. Frequencies, this stuff. And in addition, the electromagnetic field can be modeled in this. In other words, the field, the sunlight that you see on a beautiful day, the rainbow that you see after it rains, the beautiful sunset, the stars at night, all those electromagnetic fields can be modeled in this same way. And let me give you even more insight. In quantum field theory, when we're studying matter and antimatter, electrons and positive, you know, the dilithium crystals in the Enterprise, that stuff is real. Antimatter is real. It's a real thing. It's not made up. We don't have antimatter reactors, but we work with antimatter every day. Those systems are modeled with equations that you can trace almost all the way back to this, the simpler systems. This is where you get your first look at it. All right. Here's your homework assignment. So we don't have anything to turn in tomorrow except get your brain ready. And we're going to talk about equation 2310 and figure 2316 on page 661 if you have the book. And so just go ahead and read that and think about it. And hopefully you have a dream tonight about it. Get a good night's sleep. I'll see you tomorrow at 3 for the test. You're dismissed. If you want to get your homework, come on up. If you have any other questions, I'll be here for another half hour.